I think one of the things that we don't see in our world enough is that when people are wrong, they try to make excuses. The bottom line was for, and I can say his name because we talked about it on the radio yesterday. Mm-hmm. He's my son and I love him. And he's a great young man. God is going to do great things in his life. And is doing great things. But he explained how social media, how he looked at social media. It was when Mo took that clipping of that 1 minute and then put it on Instagram, his intention was not to exploit the woman or to hurt her. I don't think many times, and this is a lesson for all of us, it's a lesson for the church. And people of God, if we can't make a mistake, and we still love each other, I don't want to be in that kind of church. Because the only way that people will know that we're disciples of Christ is that we love one another. And so it was wrong, and I called Mo. I didn't really find out what was going on until about Wednesday. I caught a flu bug, and I'm not on social media. I mean, I'm not on Facebook, other than what we do with the church here. I guess I'm gonna have to get on. But when I found out about it, when it happened in service here, there's a certain amount, even in tragedy sometimes, there's a certain amount of that which makes you, because of the timing of it, because of what happens, you know, you can see somebody fall, you're not laughing at them because they fell, but you might laugh because it was funny, right? So, we're not going to stand up here this morning and say that the video wasn't funny. It was. Okay, but that being said, within the confines, if we would have just been on our Facebook Live and nobody had taken that out and sent it to other people, that then began to send it around the world, that millions of people have not viewed this. And what it has done is it has caused those enemies of the cross to be able to criticize the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. For that, I am godly sorry. And I apologize both to this church who I love, and you know it is always my heart to represent Christ and to represent you. Because I understand the way I live my life and what I do has a reflection on you. Mm-hmm. And I always want to live my life above reproach. By the help of God. I'm human just like everybody else, right? But I've tried to live my life above reproach so that God would be proud. Amen. So that I would never cause the enemies of God to be able to rail accusations against him. I've been in full-time ministry since 1983. I left my job at Household Finance in September of 1983. I have not worked a secular job since then, so I'm not a novice. I've been at this a long time. I've seen a lot. I'm a father in this faith.
Yes, yes.
Amen, amen.
And I talked with my son. He's repented, and I think it caused him to understand the impact of what he does. Sometimes we don't recognize, you know, the impact we have when we do things. Because we kind of live in our bubble and don't realize how it can affect other people. One of his fellow officers said to him, said, Mo, said, I love you. He said, but our job is to serve and protect, not to hurt. And I think it really touched his heart. Anybody that knows Mo knows that he's got a soft heart. And so I'm very proud of my son. When he does wrong, I'm going to correct it. I'm not going to be Eli.
Amen. Amen.
Oh, I'm not going to be Eli.
Amen.
I'm not going to let foolishness happen, and I don't care who you are, and not correct it. That's not who I am. Because at the end of the day, I fear God. Amen. Believe me, I fear God. I need him. I can't make him. I don't have I don't have another alternative 401k plan or something. All I got is Jesus. So I gotta live in such a way that I know that when I call on him, he's gonna answer. I gotta live in such a way that I know when my enemies come against me, they're gonna stumble and fall because God has raised up a host around me to protect me.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
And so I say to those out on Facebook that were offended by what you saw, because we took that clipping and you felt like we exploited, and that was not our intention, but that's what happened. And because of that, we are godly sorrowful. And we ask your forgiveness. Because that has never been our intention. And if you don't know who Bethesda is, this church was birthed in October of 1957. We've been in existence for 60 years, going on 61 years now. And we've lived and supported the first orphanage that was ever started in South Korea. We supported by the mother church in Tonawanda. We supported orphanages in Haiti, in Ghana, in Ivory Coast. And we still support in India every month at $1,200 a month. Even when sometimes that $1,200 hurts us in the sense of knowing that, you know, God, we got to do it by faith. It doesn't hurt us. But do you understand what I'm saying? You know, we do it sacrificially. We started and we have the only sole minority foster care agency in all of our county to take care of children. And all of 2017, because of some of the circumstances that happened with the state and the county, Bethesda supported the salaries of the staff all of last year. We could have stopped foster care because it was taken away from what we needed. But we felt that this was a ministry that was needed. Every Tuesday and Thursday, we feed people and we minister to them. And we and the word of God, as well as we minister to their natural man. Every Tuesday and Thursday. We have had sessions where we have had all night where ladies have come together and shared their issues.
Yes.
About their hurts and about their pains. In that setting where people have been real, as the world wants to say. You know, they kept it real. But it was in a setting where they could be ministered to and they could be helped. We could not minister effectively at a New Year's Eve service to this woman. Now, if you felt that we could have, then, you know, you have your opinion and maybe you need to start a church. But we did the best that we knew how. We did the best that we knew how. And, you know, I think that as the church, we've got to learn that this social media is a powerful instrument. And it can be used for God's glory, or it can be used for the church's detriment. And we need to make a decision to use it for its glory.
Amen.
Now, there are going to be other things that are going to happen in church, because we're not going to stop going live. We're real people. Mm-hmm. And if anybody that knows me, you know I'm just me. What you see on Sunday, you're going to see on Monday. You're going to see on Tuesday. God's still working on me. Sometimes you'll see me and my face will be frowned up. And you know, it's just me. I'm not up here because I'm good. I'm up here because I'm called.
Amen. Amen.
I'm up here because God is good. And never one time have I ever tried to make you believe that it's with my goodness that I'm here. It's the goodness of Jesus.
Amen.
And all that he's done for me. When I went back over the clip and when I saw it, I laughed. But then I began to read the comments. And I began to say, oh, my goodness, what do we do? And I thought about my mother. Because I recognized that that woman testifying on New Year's Eve could have easily, back in 1961, been ceremony magic. Now, I'm not in any way trying to, blow it up in any way. My mother was an alcoholic who was on the verge of a nervous breakdown when she came to this church.
My God, my God.
In 1961, because my brother's best friend, mother, was a Christian and said, you need to go to Bethesda. And God changed her life. And today, her son stands here.
By the grace.
By the grace of God.
If
he can do it for ceremony magic, surely he can do it for this woman. I'm believing God that at the end of this, there is going to be a testimony.
That's it. That's it.
There's going to bring glory,
glory
and honor to our Lord and Savior. And so, I'm going to share the word of God this morning with you. I know this was Communion Sunday, and maybe at the end we'll do communion. But like I said, this is a different Sunday.